Hello students, this video is about general account of anthocerotales and in continuation with my previous video on anthocerotales. In this video, I am going to share with you some more detail of genus anthoceros. So let's start the video. First is habitat and distribution. About 200 species of this genus are found throughout the world, means it is cosmopolitan. And is prominently present in temperate and tropical regions. The species are mainly moist and shade loving. About 25 species have been reported from India by various workers. The three common Himalayan species are Anthoceros himalayensis, Anthoceros erectus and Anthoceros chambensis. These species are common in hilly regions such as Missouri, Kumaon Hill, Chamba Valley and other places from 5,000 to 8,000 feet. Some species have been reported from South India. All the species are found in very shady and moist places as I told you earlier. They are found in the hollows of the moist rocks in dense patches. According to Cavers, some of the species grow on decaying wood also. So students, we can see that Anthoceros is cosmopolitan and it is present mainly in the hilly areas. And in Western Himalaya, Missouri, Kumaon and Chamba Valleys are its favorite place where it grow luxuriantly. Main characteristic feature of this group are the thallus gametophyte is small, dark green, dorsiventral, prostate, branched or lobed. And you can see both dorsal and ventral surface of the Anthoceros. There is no midrib and it is spongy due to presence of underlying mucilage duct. Dorsal surface varies from species to species. It is smooth in Anthoceros labis, velvety in Anthoceros crispulus and rough in Anthoceros fusiformis. So students, you can see more images of Anthoceros in natural habitat. The thallus is dark green and there is no prominent midrib. And you can see nostoc colonies which can be visible even in the habitat with the lens. Smooth walled simple rhizoids are present as you can see in this image. Ventral scales and tuberculate rhizoids are altogether absent. The thalli are dark green because of the presence of nostoc colonies, which may be easily seen with the help of lens from the underside of the thallus. They are simple, without cellular differentiation, and have 1 to 6 chloroplasts per cell, which are oval or discoid with lamellar structure like higher plants. Chloroplasts also contain pyrenoids as you seen in algae. Nostoc colonies or nostoc gain entry from the slime pores. So students, you can see that chloroplasts are distributed uniformly over the whole thallus and these are oval or discoid and 1 to 6 in number. And you can see that in internal structure there are prominent algal colonies and algae mainly are from the class Cyanophyceae. At the underside you can see mucilage ducts are there which make the thallus spongy. In this image you can see the prominent chloroplasts are there which also contain pyrenoids. Next is apical growth. The apical growth of Anthoceros is a controversial topic, whether it takes place by single apical cell or by a group of apical cell. According to Smith, the apical growth of the thallus is initiated by the single apical cell, but according to Litjab, the apical growth in this genus takes place by several marginal apical cells, while according to Mehra and Hendo, the apical growth in Anthoceros erectus and Anthoceros himalayensis takes place by a group of cells situated in the depression at the apex of the thallus. So students, you can see that different scientists have different opinion regarding the apical growth. So nothing can be predicted confirmly. However, according to Mehra, apical growth takes place by group of cells. Next is reproduction. The vegetative reproduction takes place by various ways. First is by progressive growth and death of the thallus. So students, in this vegetative propagation, some of the cells undergo progressive growth and decay, and the resultant cells then leads to formation of new thallus. This method is not so common in Anthocerone as it is common in Ericea and Marchantia. Next is by tubers. In certain species of Anthocereus, the thallus become thickened at several places on the margin. Each marginal thickening are called the tubers. These tubers are perinating structure. They survive in the drought condition. On the advent of favorable condition, they develop into new thalli. The tubers are formed in Anthocereus labris, Anthocereus tuberosus, Anthocereus halei, Anthocereus pearsoni, and Anthocereus himalensis. So you can see in this image, tuber arises from the margins and they perinate the unfavorable condition. On the reach of favorable condition, they help in the regeneration. Next is by gamma. In some of the species of Anthocereus, gamma have been found. The gamma have been recorded from the species of Anthocereus granulosus and Anthocereus formosae, etc. Each such gamma develop into a new thallus, but it is not such prominent as in case of Marchantia. Next is by persistent growing apexes. According to Campbell, the thalli of the species of Pearsoni and Fusiformis become completely dried up in the summers, leaving only growing apexes with adjacent tissues. These apices face the drought condition. On the approach of favorable condition, these apices develop into new thallus. So students, you can see these are the means of vegetative reproduction. Next is apospory. In Anthocereus, apospory is also found, where unspecialized cell of the many parts of the sporogonium, especially from intercalary, meristematic zone, subepidermal and sporogenous region of the capsule, form the gametophytic thallus. Students, as the name says, apospory means formation of gametophyte without the formation of spores. This phenomenon is called apospory. The thalli are diploid but normal in appearance. Students, this apospory is very, very important and quite often asked in practical viva as well as in interviews. So very simple, you can recall it. Apospory means away from spore formation, where a diploid gametophyte develop from the any of sporophytic tissue except the spore, and it looks like normal gametophyte but it is diploid in nature. Next is sexual reproduction. The species of Anthocereus may be homothallic, that is monoecious, or heterothallic. Some of the homothallic species are Anthocereus fusiformis, Anthocereus punctatus. Kashyap recorded Himalayensis as a dioecious species, but Mehra and Hendo have reported the same as monoecious but protandrous. The heterothallic species are Anthocereus pearsoni, Anthocereus halei, Anthocereus erectus, and others. And the sex organs are Antheridia and Archegonia, which are found embedded in the tissues of dorsal side of the thallus. The mature Antheridium is stalked and club-shaped. The Antheridium proper is covered by a single layer jacket. Inside the jacket, there are numerous androcytes which metamorphosis into the anthrozoites, as you can see in this image. On the maturation of Antheridium, the roof of the antheridial chamber disintegrates. With the result, the antheridia are exposed to outside. Soon after, the antheridia absorb water and rust in their apical ends, giving way the anthrozoite to move outside. So students, one special thing you can notice in case of Anthocereus, that anthrozoites are found embedded inside the thallus, and you can see there is covering and it is called as roof. unlike previous orders, like in marking shales, you have seen anthrozoid, they arises on the receptacle that is called anthidiophore, while in gingermanials you have seen that anthidium develop in the pits or depression, but in this case they develop inside the thallus and there is roof or covering outside the anthidium. Then is anthrozoid. The anthrozoid is spindle-like and biciliate. Cilia are attached to the anterior end of the body, sometime just near the attaching point of the flagella to the body. The blepharoplast, which is the structure which rise to cilia, is visible. The anthrozoids swim in the water by the lacing movement of their flagella and reach to archegonia. So you can see here roof, then group of anthrozoid. Finally, they break up and liberate the anthrozoids, which then finally reach to archegonium. Next is archegonium. The archegonia are again found embedded in the thallus. They remain in direct contact with the vegetative cells of the tissue of the thallus lateral to them, unlike the anthidium, which are covered by the roof and are separated from the vegetative cells of the thallus. Archegonia do not possess jacket trail cells around them, because they don't need much protection because they are directly embedded in the thallus. The development of archegonium begins from a single superficial cell. These cells become prominent and act as archegonial initial. You can see here the archegonia, which is directly embedded in the thallus, or the vegetative cells are very close to the archegonia, and you can see that's why it lacks strial cell jacket, unlike the previous orders where archegonia are either exposed or are present in the depressions. On the maturation of the archegonia, the venter canal cell and neck canal cell become gelatinized. Thus, a mature archegonium is flask-like in shape, without neck canal cell and with an egg in the venter. At the top of the neck of the archegonium, there are four cover cells which become separated from the archegonium as soon as the gelatinization of the venter and neck canal cell is over. So, students, you can see there are prominent cover cell, and when their gelatinization, neck canal cell and venter canal cell dissolve and disappear. So in mature archegonium you will find egg and passage for the entry of the sperm. Next is fertilization. You know very well, prior to fertilization the cover cell become detached from the archegonium and the neck canal cell become gelatinized. Through the medium of water, the anthrozoids enter the mouth of archegonium. The anthrozoids are attached chemotactically, means there are some secretions from the archegonia which attract anthrozoid. Ultimately, one lucky anthrozoid penetrates the egg and the fertilization is affected. The male and female nuclei unite to each other producing a zygote. Zygote is diploid and this is the beginning of sporophytic stage. Next is structure of mature sporogonium. The mature sporophyte consists of a bulbous foot and a smooth, slender, erect, cylindrical structure called capsule. The capsule varies in length from 2 to 15 cm in different species. The sporogonium appear like a bristle or horn. Hence, the species are called hornwort, as you can see in these images. The embryo undergo division, resulting in the formation of an elongated structure with bulbous base. It has three parts: basal foot, meristematic region, and the capsule. As you can see in this image, foot, meristematic region, and capsule. Meristematic region divide to form horn-like capsule. The foot provide anchorage for the sporophyte to gametophytic thallus and absorption of water and mineral. Meristematic region constantly add new cells to the capsule and it help in the capsule to live long. Students, the mature capsule is long, slender, cylindrical, unlike normal gametophytic thallus. It show complex tissue differentiation. As capsule is divided into three region, outer capsule tissue, which have outermost epidermis with stomata. Epidermis is made up of vertically elongated cell with cutanized outer capsule wall. Below epidermis, there is loosely arranged panchymatous photosynthetic jacket cells, also called as archisporium. Middle sporogenous tissue, which is cylinder of cell around the columella and responsible for the spore formation. Inner columella for mechanical support to sporophyte and in water and mineral conduction. So students, you can see that different region of sporophyte show a progressive growth and development of cells like spores and elaters from spore mother cell and elater mother cell. As the elaters lack spiral thickening, so they are called as pseudo-elater, and it is the main difference between elaters of Marquand shales and elaters of anthocerotales. Students, you can see here different zones of the capsule. Outermost layer, which has epidermis and stomata, are also there. Then there is archisporium, also contain chlorophyll and responsible for the photosynthesis. So we can say that sporophyte is not purely parasitic, it is semi-parasite. And you will see that prominent stomatic zone is there, which is responsible for the continuous growth of the capsule. There is also columella, which help in the conduction of the nutrients. So students, that's all about the sporophyte. Next is affinities of anthoceros, or primitive and advanced character of anthoceros. Students, the thallus of anthoceros shows both primitive and advanced character. Anthoceros on one hand form a connecting link with the chlorophyce, leverwort, mosses, and on the other hand it is linked with the primitive pteridophytes. So let's see these characters. First is resemblance with chlorophyce. Like green algae, the thallus is simple green gametophytic thalloid plant body. There is presence of lens-shaped chloroplast per cell. Definite shape of the chloroplast is there. Presence of pyrenoid. Structure and function of pyrenoid is similar to that of green algae. That is, they form starch grains at periphery. So these are the characters similar to algae. Next is resemblance with leverwort. Like some of the leverwort, they have simple green gametophytic plant body without any differentiation of tissues like palea. They have similar apical growth. There is biflagellated anthrozoid. Perisenal division separate amphitheecium and endothecium. Archisporium is differentiated into spore mother cells and elater mother cells. Next is advanced character. Resemblance with mosses. Presence of highly differentiated and ventilated system of the capsule wall. Presence of columella, that is endothecial, means arises from the inner cells. Means whenever division occur in the zygote, it develops from the inner cell. Presence of reduced archisporium. Archisporium arch over the columella like the sphagnum. Students, archisporium is the covering over the columella. Resemblance with pteridophytes. Gametophytic plant body resemble with the fern prothallus. You know very well, prothallus is the structure which leads to formation of anthridium and archegonium. And it is quite similar with the anthoceros because both anthridium and archegonia are found embedded in the thallus. So it resembles with the prothallus of fern. It has sunken sex organs. Structure of archegonia is similar. Semi-parasitic sporophyte of anthoceros resemble with the primitive fossil vascular plant of the psilophytes. So students, these are the point which resemble with the pteridophytes. So that's all about this video. I hope you understood the topic. Thank you for listening.